Well, it is 4 o'clock. Let's start. Again, thank you very much for joining us. And let me share my full screen with you. So welcome to this webinar that we have called Transparency Regulation and the EU Food and Feed Industry, the latest updates. And the first thing that I want to clarify to you is that this is not a full webinar for covering all the aspects of the transparency regulation. We already did that, and we have a webinar for that that is in our YouTube channel. So if you want to see the full description of all the new aspects of the transparency regulation, please go to our website. Here, we are just going to go through the latest information that we have collected from the publication of the practical arrangements and also from meetings with EFSA. Okay? So let's start. As probably many of you already know, we have been calling it the transparency regulation, but the official name is Regulation 2019-1381, and it's going to apply starting next Saturday, 27th of March. As with the previous webinar, we are not going to be covering these couple of points that are going to apply from the 1st of July of 2022 that are related to the EFSA Management Board, the Scientific Committee, and the Scientific Panels. When you want to know what all the transparency regulation is about, you not only need to work with the document of the transparency regulation, but additionally, you need to use three documents that were published on the EFSA website this past January that are the practical arrangements. So we have a document dealing with the practical arrangements of pre-submission phase of public consultations. We have a second document that deals with the transparency and confidentiality. And then we have a third document that deals with the confidentiality, but related to Regulation 1107 from 2009, that is related to plant protection products. So this document, it is very similar to these other documents, but because on the risk assessment of plant protection products, member states are involved. So you have that separate document that details all the small difference that are going to apply for the specific case of plant protection products. And the first document that deals with pre-submission phase and public consultations contains the details of plant protection products that are going to be different for all the procedures contained in this practical arrangement document, okay? So now you know everything that you need to have at hand when you are reviewing how this regulation is going to apply to your dossier. As a reminder also, please take into account that this regulation is going to apply to 9 different legislative areas, to call it in a way. So everything related with food, because it affects the general food law and also includes plant protection products, food contact materials, that, by the way, was one of the questions that you sent previously in the past days. Some of you wanted to know if it will apply to food contact materials. Yes, it will. And also, I just want to confirm you that we got the feedback from EFSA that it also applies to health claims dossiers. Okay, so in case you have any doubt. These are the main points or the main new figures that the amendment to the general food law are bringing to Europe. But again, we are not going to be talking about all of them, only those for which we have news, okay, or things that we didn't know the first time of the webinar and that now have been clarified. So let's start with pre-submission advice. This is the pre-submission advice for new applications. By the way, every time that on a slide you see the name of the article described with this format, this is referring to the article on the transparency regulation. And then when we are talking about articles of the practical arrangements, it's clearly specified on the corresponding slide, okay? So for new applications, the first thing remember is that for new applications, pre-submission advice is optional, okay? You decide if you want to or not. So you're going to request advice to EFSA in 2 particular points. It is not a question about everything or anything. It is just about the rules applicable and the content required. So what we know now, thanks to the practical arrangements, is how are you going to request pre-submission advice? You're going to request pre-submission advice within the pre-application ID through the EFSA notification of a studies database that should be up and running on the 27th of March. So once you know that you're gonna start to put together a dossier, and you want to start notifying studies, so the first thing that you need to do is you go to the system, you request access to EFSA. After EFSA grants you the access, you go to the system, and the first thing that you need to do is to create your pre-application ID. And within that pre-application ID is where, among other things, you are going to request pre-submission advice. So in which format is the pre-submission advice be delivered and also requested? It is foreseen that mainly in written format, but if EFSA considers that it's necessary, they could arrange teleconferences or face-to-face meetings. How many times can you request pre-submission advice? Ideally, you should send one request with all of your questions, but you could receive advice up until 2 times, provided that you do not repeat the questions. Do you have to pay a fee? That was a very important question back in 2020, and the answer is no. So timelines, how is going to work? How long before preparing the dossier you should request the pre-submission advice? The recommendation from the practical arrangements is 6 months. In my practical experience, I would say that is too short notice because we start preparing these dossiers well before that. But again, that is the recommendation from EFSA. That means that you are not limited to that time. You could go for the pre-submission advice before. How much time will it take to get it? So within 15 working days, EFSA is going to communicate to the applicant if the request is accepted or not, after you hit the button and send the request to EFSA through the database. But remember, you need to be within scope. It should be pre-submission advice for the content and for the rules applicable. If you are asking something else, you are going to, EFSA is going to tell you, we do not accept this request. And then, if EFSA actually accepts the request, the advice is going to be provided within working days after the acceptance of the request. It is very important that in relation to pre-submission advice, you notice what it has been described in Article 11 of the practical arrangements. So the first 2 points mainly mean that it's not because EFSA provided that pre-submission advice that you could not be requested something else or something different, or the authorities during the risk assessment or after the risk assessment. And it's also very important for you to know or to notice point 3. That says that the potential applicant shall not be bound by any general pre-submission advice. So this means that you can relax, you can opt for requesting the pre-submission advice. And then if you do not agree with that, you are not legally bound to do what you were told at that phase, and then you can not do it and just provide your justifications, okay? Then the notification of studies, one of the most important points that is raising a lot of concerns or confusion or anxiety about how it's going to work. So you know that EFSA is going to establish the database of studies commissioned by a feed or food business operator for an application. And there are going to be 2 parties involved in the notification of studies. So from one side, the applicant has to notify the studies, and then in the other side, the laboratory or contract list organization also has to notify the information. So in the case of the applicant, what is the type of information that needs to be notified? Because I have seen that many people think that they have to notify way more than what they are actually asked to notify. So they have to notify, of course, who they are, the name of the applicant, the title of the study, the scope, the name of the laboratory or CRO, and the start and end date. And then thanks to the practical arrangements, we now know that within scope, there are a little bit more of things that we need to notify. So this is the text from Annex 2 of the practical arrangements. The first part is what we already discussed. And then within a study scope, you need to notify the intenders to the area. So this will be a feed additive, a plant protection product, a novel food. A study type, if it is an efficacy, a safety study, or genotoxicity study. The study international standard certification, if there is one, not necessarily you need to follow one in case that you don't have it, you can put it none. What is the study objective? And of course, the test item object of your application. And then optionally, because it, sometimes it happens, if there is a study internal reference ID, there is assigned either by the food business operator or by the laboratory, it is optional that you also include that information when you notify your study, okay? Important clarifications that were provided in the practical arrangement. What is the study start date and what is the plan completion date of the study? So regarding a starting date of the study, is the experimental starting date, or the meaning the date on which the first study specific data are expected to be collected. And if you cannot determine this, you could classify or determine what is your study start date in one of the following ways. In a study that you conduct according to an established protocol, the starting date is going to be the date of signature of the protocol. And then for studies not conducted according to an established protocol, I have no experience with those. The starting date of the study means the date of definition of the study plan. So if you do not have a protocol, I am assuming that this will mean something like when you say, okay, we agree to perform the study or something like that. I do not know of any studies that you perform without a protocol. So I am not that worried about the study starting date. I think that this is going to be very easy to determine when, for example, an efficacy study with animals, well, the animals are going to arrive this day, that is not something that you can improvise, you need to plan it and you need to plan it very carefully. However, where I think that is going to be a little bit more tricky is with the definition of the plan completion date of the study. Because it means the provisional date on which the study report is expected to be signed. And many of you probably know that we sign the final study report when they are final. And that sometimes can take years. I can tell you that right now, I am trying to finalize the study reports for the studies that were conducted in 2018 and 2019. And different things happened. We have not been able to close those reports. So if we take this approach, it's going to be very difficult. Were more tricky, not necessarily more difficult, but more tricky. But then in the specific case where the provisional date of expected signature of the study report cannot be established, the plan completion date should be determined as follows. The plan completion date means the provisional date on which the study report is expected to be generated. But here it doesn't, I mean, I'm not clear if it is prepared, if it means it is expected to be generated in the terms of the first draft report. So it is not clear for me. Or you could go with the second point. If it is not possible to establish the provisional date of the generation of the study report and a laboratory analysis is generated, the plan completion date means the provisional date of generation of the final results. So in my personal opinion, I think that this is going to be easier to determine. What is the date in which you expect to have the final results? When you are clear that you are going to review your results and you are going to double check them and you are comfortable that you can use those results, that data set to start your analysis, I think that that is going to be easier to predict than the date when you are going to sign the report. But this is going to be up to the applicant and, of course, in close negotiation with the CROs or laboratories. Another thing that you need to consider for the notification of studies is that the notification obligation applies to a studies commission or carry out as of the 27th of March of 2021. We have the opportunity to ask directly to EFSA, does this only apply to studies that I perform after the 27th of March? Meaning the study start date, and EFSA say yes. Then the practical arrangement also provided a clarification on what the terminology without delay means, because there was a lot of concern since in the text of the transparency regulation says that you need to notify your studies without delay. And in many cases, it could happen that you and I are talking about this study and we agree actually about the general protocol of the study, but then we decide to perform it next year. So this was generating a lot of concern. And then the definition is that you should notify the study without delay once the European Union becomes a potential market. And this is also very important because sometimes you could carry out studies in the European Union at the time that the transparency regulation applies, but you are not thinking about EU registration. You are thinking about, for example, a registration for China or a registration for the US. So you have to notify the studies if they were performed after the 27, but once you decide that you want to target or you want to prepare a registration for the European Union. All studies shall be submitted before the starting date, and I'm going to come back to this comment here in red after the last point. But remember that if there are reasons for notifying studies after the study start date, you could do it, but then you should provide proper justifications or you could get the penalties that we are going to talk about later on the presentation. And then remember that regarding studies performed in the past, you only need to notify studies that were performed after the 27th of March. And if it is for a non-EU registration, is what I told you. If you perform them in May of this year, but the registration is not for the EU, you do not need to notify it. But if you decide next year that you want to apply for the EU registration, then you need to notify them by then. And then you have to provide a justification to EFSA about why you are notifying after the starting date of the study. Okay. The Article 18 contains two very important parts about the obligation to submit a study notification. So we are going to review first the part that is underlined. A study submitted by an applicant after the submission of an application, either during the assessment of the validity or admissibility of the application or in relation to the risk assessment, should also be subjected to a study notification obligation. This will be the case, notice that are after the submission of the application. Imagine that you submit today. I'm going to go for a very extreme example. And tomorrow you actually think, you know what? I think that I should have performed this study. And I'm going to start to perform it now, and I'm going to submit it to EFSA during the risk assessment as soon as it is ready. You can do it. But you just have to make sure that you, because, well, the example I am giving it today in March, but imagine that the example was in April 2021. You can do that, but you just need to make sure that you comply with the notification obligation. And then the second part is particularly relevant for the moment that we are living now, where many dossiers are going to be submitted before the 27th of March. So in the event that no pre-application activities were carried out before the submission of an application, a study submitted by an applicant after the submission of such application in relation to the risk assessment are not required to be associated to any pre-application ID. This will be the case again. You submit your full dossier before the 27th of March, but then in May, next May, you get a clock stop from EFSA, where EFSA asks you to perform a safety or an efficacy study. Because that study is performed after the 27th of March, you need to notify the study. But because you prepared the full dossier before the 27th of March, you do not have a pre-application ID. So this just confirms that you have to perform the study, have to notify it, but you do not, and you can just go to the system and submit the study without having that notification of the study associated to a pre-application ID. Okay, so keep that in mind, particularly for dossiers being submitted before the 27th of March. Then, what happens if you notify the study, but then the study for what that you want to withdraw from the system that information that you submitted because something happened? You can do it, but first, the first criteria, you have to withdraw the notification of the study before the plan completion date. That is going to be the very first thing important, blah, blah, blah. The most important thing, or the first most important thing. Withdraw before the plan completion completion date. And then the second thing is that even though you withdraw before the plan completion date, at application submission phase, the applicant shall provide justifications for the withdrawal. And then the timing of that withdrawal is going to be taken into consideration by the authority so they can assess if they accept your justification. If they don't accept it, the penalty that we're going to discuss later is going to apply about the 6 months suspension of the assessment process. And notice the following. In this case, that it means to the case where the justifications provided by the applicant for the withdrawal of a study that was notified, if EFSA doesn't agree that you have a justification for doing this, in addition to the penalty, you are going to have to submit all data that was delivered by the reference laboratory or testing facility, even without the study had been completed. So make sure that if you are in this situation, you comply with both. You withdraw the study before the plan completion date, and additionally, once you have your dossier ready, you submit the justification, okay? Or you are going to get into trouble. Then, like I told you, the notification of the studies is performed by two parties. So here we're talking about the information that is submitted by the laboratories or CRO. It's basically the same. It just changes, of course, the name of the laboratory and CRO, and that they are notifying the FPO name. And it's very important if you are people from laboratories hearing me out right now from CROs, keep in mind that you could be the entity that notifies or the entity that co-notifies. So you could start the notification process and then the applicant can co-notify, or the other way around. So it's going to be very important that both the applicants and the laboratories discuss how this is going to work when you are planning the study, or this could get very messy, okay? And now, because we are in Brexit times, what happens with laboratories or CROs that are located in the UK? The UK is now a third country, and European regulation, European laws only applies in the European Union. So if you are located in the UK and you are a laboratory or a CRO, you do not need to comply with the co-notification of the study. And the only exception is Northern Ireland. If you are in Northern Ireland, it does apply. And remember that this co-notification obligation also applies to CROs located in third countries with agreements with the European Union. But so far, we do not know of any list, okay, that contains this information. So we keep assuming there are going to be those countries in the European economical area, but we still have to wait and see. Another important question for CROs, how many people per company are going to be allowed to be registered in the EFSA notification of studies database? So this is how it's going to work. One person per company, either a consultant, a laboratory, or a food business operator is going to request access to the system. And for you to know, it's taking a lot of time. I already requested access on behalf of Perantech more than 1 month ago, and EFSA has not authorized me yet. And I sent a follow-up email, and they just told me, when the process finishes, you're going to be registered. So that person is going to be known as the chief notificator. After that person gets granted access by EFSA, this person will have the responsibility of giving authorization to other people without the company. And this same person is going to be the person in charge of giving the access and also deleting the access, to call it in a way, to sign you off from the system. Imagine that you leave the company. However, during a discussion with EFSA, EFSA realized that they still do not have a system or do not have the procedure ready to how it's going to work if the chief notificator of the company, for example, is right now working for the food business operator and tomorrow quits and start working for a laboratory. and want to start to notify on behalf of the laboratory. So EFSA is working now on developing like the guidelines about that, how it's going to work. And well, they will let us know once they have it ready. These are the penalties that I was talking about. If you do not notify the studies properly, you could get a 6 months penalty delaying the assessment process. So the first two cases, it could be that you submit the study, but you do not notify it, or that you notify the study and do not submit it. So if this happens, you could get that 6 months delayed, and then the clock is gonna start ticking again after you either notify the study or submit the study. So these two first parts are going to be assessed at validation, okay? And if something happens, EFSA is going to notify to you the decision at validation. But the third part, there is the penalty that you could get if you notify the study, you submit the study, but you submit partial information. This is going to be assessed during or determined during the risk assessment. So EFSA is going to contact you. They are going to tell you, hey, this is not complete. Why? You will be given the opportunity to provide the justification if you didn't do it when you submitted the dossier. If EFSA agrees, then okay. But if EFSA doesn't agree, you could have the 6 month penalty, and then your assessment process get delayed. And again, the clock is gonna start ticking again after you submit the pending information. A study. What is an study? This was not defined on the regulation, and we finally got the definition on the practical arrangements, okay? And it's very important because it's gonna tell us what is it that I need to notify to the database. So a study means an experiment or set of experiments in which a test item is examined under laboratory conditions or in the environment to obtain data with respect to the properties and or the safety of the test item, which is relevant for the submission. So because of this very wide definition, we understood that also that analytical data that you generate to characterize your test item will fall into the definition of what is a study. And I'm going to come back to this later, okay? The consultation of third parties. This is the extra step that is going to happen for the renewal of authorizations that we need to do for products such as feed additives. In this case, before you do anything, the applicant needs to notify a list of intended studies that they intend to perform for the renewal to EFSA. And it's recommended that they do it at least 5 months before commissioning the studies. And the definition is that you should only notify the list of intended studies if these studies are new in relation to the original application. But notice that I am highlighting this in red. There is a reason for that. What is the information that you need to notify for the studies on the list? Basically the same information that we already saw for the notification of studies, and what it changes is 0.5. So for study design, you need to notify the study guideline if there is one, but if there is no study guideline, you just need to provide a description of the study design. And notice, and this is very important, that providing the detailed study protocol is optional, okay? So EFSA takes that information, launch a public consultation, including on the study design, and everyone is going to have access to the public consultation. So how is it going to work? What are the timelines for this consultation of third parties? There is going to be administrative checks that is going to last 10 working days after the date of receipt. And if something is missing, the 10 working days are going to count after they receive the missing information. Then the public consultation is going to be launched within 10 working days from the completion of the administrative check. The actual public consultation is going to be open for 3 calendar weeks. Once the consultation finishes, all the comments received, and comments is that, the comments from the stakeholders, not the advice from EFSA. All those comments should be made publicly available without delay. And then the actual provision of the renewal advice, that advice is going to be provided within 30 working days after the closure of the consultation, okay? And mainly it is foreseen that it will be provided in written format through the notification of the studies database. So like I say, EFSA will take the outcome of the public consultation to provide advice on what? On the content of the application and on study design. In this case, in the case of renewal pre-submission advice, even though this point it is mandatory for renewal, it happens the same. Applicants are not bound to comply with the pre-submission advice, and also the authorities could request something else. So in the case of consultation of third parties for renewal of authorizations, before you prepare the dossier, you need to comply with two previous steps. Submit the list of intended studies that goes to public consultation, and then you get advice. And then when you actually have the final list of studies that you are going to perform for a renewal, you need to notify the studies. And the system is going to work in a way that is going to allow you to recycle information from the list of intended studies and use it for the actual notification of studies. Now, as you remember, what type of studies you need to notify for the public consultation of a renewal? New studies. But what happens? Happens that there are consequences of the definition of a study. So in the case of a renewal of authorization of a fidelity, this is the type of information that you need to submit in a renewal dossier. Always new batch-to-batch variation data and purity data, results of the post-market monitoring and literature review for supporting safety, and something for section 4 if you change something in relation to the original application. But what happens, and we ask this directly to EFSA, are batch-to-batch data and purity data considered studies? The answer was yes. So since you always submit new data for these two items, that means that in a renewal dossier, you are always submitting new studies. And if you are always submitting new studies, that means that for all renewal dossier of fidelities, you always have to go through the first step of the public consultation and to notify the list of intended studies. So be careful about this, those of you working with renewal dossiers. Consultation of third parties. This is when you have the dossier ready. You submit your dossier. Now you have to prepare the confidential and the non-confidential version. After validation, EFSA releases the non-confidential version. And then they launch the public consultation to determine if there is new another information out there relevant for the assessment. When the risk assessment finishes, EFSA publishes the EFSA opinion plus the outcome of the public call for data. Now, there has been a lot of concern in this point in the release of the non-confidential version related to the fact that in many dossiers, we include literature reviews. And in those literature reviews, because we need to include copy of the papers, for many papers that are not publicly available, we have to pay. But that copy is only seen until now by EFSA. But if EFSA is going to release a copy for that, that will imply that we will need to pay for a copyright license that would allow us to release that copy to the whole world. Once the non-confidential version of the dossier is released. And as you can imagine, that will have huge economical consequences, a huge economical impact in the cost of your total application. So we recently received feedback for this. Our president, Dr. Eleanor McCartney, is also president of the Association of Veterinary Consultants, the ABC, and they sent a letter to the EC expressing concern about several points of the transparency regulation. And this point about the papers, the copyright, was one of them. So we recently learned the European Commission told us that relevant bibliographic reference or citations with these publications for which you have to pay, and then you tell to EFSA, for whatever reason, I cannot pay a copyright license for distribution to the whole world. So what you need to do in these cases is just to include the relevant bibliographic reference or citation where these publications are available to the public in the non-confidential version of the dossier. And that will be enough, okay? Then regarding confidentiality, these are the information for which EFSA is ready to accept confidentiality claims. That is basically the same kind of thing for which we can request confidentiality now. And remember, now it's EFSA who is going to assess the confidentiality claims, not the EC. So how we request confidentiality under the transparency regulation? We need to provide justifications and we need to prepare two applications, the confidential and the non-confidential version of the dossier. Now, regarding how to provide justifications, we got useful guidelines in the new practical arrangements, specifically in Article 10, okay? So the Article 10 gives you a series of points that you should cover when you are drafting the justifications for confidentiality for the different sections or annexes or whatever. But there again, there were concerns about this list because the impression was like, okay, any what happens if I think that I have a valid confidentiality claim, but I cannot comply with all of these lists? Or my confidentiality justification is different. Are you going to reject that argument? And we also got a reply from the EC through the in the letter that was sent to the ABC. And what the EC told the ABC is that these criteria, these points in Article 10, are in fact rebuttable presumptions. Applicants that do not meet the set thresholds can still provide duly verifiable justifications and have the opportunity to be successful in their confidentiality claims. So if you have your proper justification and it's not here, do not worry. Draft it and submit it to EFSA because the authorities are going to consider it and you could be successful. Remember that this confidentiality decision should be taken within 10 calendar weeks after EFSA received the request, after validation. And also another important point is what is going to happen if you decide to withdraw your dossier after you submit the dossier, because remember that at that point, after the dossier is considered valid, the non-confidential version will be publicly available on the EFSA website. So what happens if you do not agree with what EFSA tells you? You know what? I do not agree with your confidentiality claims. And you want to withdraw the dossier? So once you do it, the authority should delete from its website without delay all the information that was publicly available. And of course, your confidentiality information will never be released unless you agree to it. But please notice that the authority is going to store one copy of the withdrawn information, documents, or data in its archive for auditing purposes. And also remember that confidentiality is going to be assessed now twice. After validation and after the risk assessment. So you cannot breathe until you go to the point before the EFSA opinion. EFSA could decide to change something during the risk assessment, so be aware of that. So this is the final summary about how the public consultation and the confidentiality assessment will work. And by the way, this comes from a very helpful EFSA fact sheet that I found a couple of years ago, and actually is the only place where I have been able to find an explanation that allow me to locate well how the different steps is going to work. For me, it's not a straightforward from the text of either the transparency regulation or the practical arrangements. So you're going to submit the dossier to EFSA, and after validation, EFSA is going to publish the non-confidential dossier, but it's not going to launch the public consultation. Then they are going to perform the confidential assessment, and after that, once the full confidentiality decision is taken, the full set of studies is going to be published, with the exception, of course, of publish of the confidential data. But this makes sense to me because what EFSA wants is to launch the public consultation with the true final non-confidential version. And what happens? That the confidential assessment needs to finish before the public consultation, because EFSA could decide to exclude something from the confidential assessment. So you will need to change the confidential and the non-confidential versions, so the public consultation could happen with the actual true last version of the non-confidential dossier. Then the public consultation is going to be open for 3 calendar weeks, and according to this diagram, it's going to start in parallel to the EFSA risk assessment. And then by the end, you are going to get the EFSA opinion together with the outcome of the call for data. So this is everything related to the actual webinar content. And now, before taking some questions from the chat, I'm going to give answers to the questions that we received during the time where the registration for the webinar was open. So one of the first questions, are the analyses in relation with the confirmation of the product specification provided in the certificate of analysis? Like, for example, microbial analysis, or this is what is called purity analysis, or heavy metals, again, purity analysis, considered as studies and therefore must be notified to EFSA. As I told you, we got confirmation from EFSA, and also considering the definition of a study, the answer is yes, and you need to notify those studies to the EFSA database. Can a laboratory have several contact persons or a single one per laboratory? As I explained before, one person per entity, either food business operator, laboratory, CRO, needs to register, needs to request the access. EFSA is going to check the information that you provided. After they agree, they will get back to you and will confirm your access, will allow you access. So you will be the main contact, the contact authorized by EFSA. And then you, within your organization, will be able to give, to authorize people to register information in the system, okay? But remember, EFSA recommends you to keep the number of people registered in the system to the minimum, even though so far there is not a limit. It is not that if you register 10 people, the system is going to tell you, you cannot authorize nobody else. At least not until the last update that we got from EFSA, okay? Do non-GLP toxicity studies, like dose range finding and pilot studies, also have to be notified in the register? Okay, so in the case of, or in my experience, many times the type of dose range finding studies are part of the general design of a study, for example, of a genotoxicity study. So it is not that you need to notify first that preliminary study, to call it in a way, and then you need to notify, secondly, the main study. Is that both parts belong to the same study, and you are going to generate one study report that is going to describe everything. So you do not need two notifications. It's just one notification with the corresponding starting date of the first test that you perform, even though if it is the dose range finding study, and then one notification, and you just need to explain everything that you did, even the preliminary part in the final study report. And then the pilot study, what you do with that is going to depend. Are you going to submit that study to EFSA? Could you also classify that pilot study as something that belongs to the main study? And maybe you could do the same thing. It's like, okay, I plan my general study, and the first step of my general study is a pilot study. So again, you do not need two notifications, just one. And in the full study report, you explain the whole thing. Now, if you do a pilot study in your backyard or private in your company, something very small scale because you want to find out something, and you are not going to submit those results in any capacity for EFSA assessment, so I will say in that case it doesn't apply because it's not a study that is going to support your application. But it depends on how you define it, so you need to look into that, okay? Do you have to notify studies post 27th of March? We have already been completed in some cases years ago. The criteria for notifying a study is basically the study start date. That is what I can tell you with all the information that I have to date 18th of March 2021. So if you perform the study, it doesn't matter where, before the 27th of March, you do not need to notify it to the study database. But remember that if you use that study and you include it in a dossier that is going to be assessed under the transparency regulation, you do need to provide a justification in the dossier about why you didn't notify the study. So do not think like, okay, I don't need to say anything about it because EFSA is going to see the study start date. No, provide the justification in the dossier, okay? Will this apply to all applications under EFSA, like food contact materials? Remember, food contact materials are covered by the general food law, food law, and it's specifically specified in the legislative act affected by the transparency regulation. So the answer is yes. And that's it from my part. So now